Yes, Andrea, please get ready. And Andrea, again, I have known him forever since his graduate years, since our graduate years. And Andrea has done amazing work on animals, frogs in the Bitsi lab. And from that earlier work, he really has made his name when he moved back to Italy. He has made his name in trying to identify synergies in the neuromuscular substrate and to develop different ways of extracting and describing these synergies in reaching and mostly in reaching movements, reaching and manipulation movements. So this really is when somebody now talks about muscle synergies, Andrea Davella is the first name that comes to mind here. And this is always an achievement. I think each of us would like to have such a concept attached to our names. But as we just discussed, Andrea has a wider range than that, and he has turned into embracing the full complexity of whole body actions, often in the concept of throwing, but I'm not quite sure what you're going to show us. So let us know.
Thank you, Dagmar. Thank you very much for your very kind introduction. And thank also to Odd for inviting me to this really exciting workshop today. So indeed, today I would like to address an issue that is often neglected in motor control and motor learning in human studies, at least, that is of inter-individual differences, as my question was sort of leading to. But I also, as you were saying in your introduction, will address this issue in the context of motor modularity. That is the idea that human motor control may be simplified by organizing a few muscle synergies. But since the topic here of the workshop is really learning, in a modular control, learning of new motor skills require organizing new synergies. And since in a real life, motor skills, often there are not a single solution, but multiple solution, a key question is then whether inter-individual differences come actually from different synergies or from different learning abilities for learning synergies. So to address this question today, I would like to briefly introduce two approaches. First, I will present new methods to completely describe inter-individual different strategies in a real-life motor skill, exactly as Dagmar was suggesting in throwing, unconstrained throwing. But second, then I will also discuss how virtual surgeries that are remapping of muscle forces in virtual manipulation tasks allow to investigate systematically the learning of new synergies. So the idea of motor modularity, of muscle synergies, comes from the attempt to explain how the human nervous system succeeds in coordinating many muscles to achieve complex skills. And to this audience, of course, it's not surprising that learning complex skill is very challenging, as these videos from the DARPA challenge, DARPA final a few years ago show. Now, if we consider even a simple manual skill like reaching for an object and grasping an object, it is clear that from a computational point of view, what is needed essentially to perform this task from sensory motor control is having control policies, a policy that uses sensory information to plan and execute a movement that requires activating the right muscle patterns. However, the question is how the nervous system and the neural circuitry achieves these. Now, the idea of modularity can be simply illustrated in very simplified schematic you see here. That is essentially, we know that the nervous system is a highly complex recurrent neural network. This is just a schematic. But and a neural network can learn arbitrary mapping and can learn it, also can implement through its dynamic represent computation, like an optimal control computation. However, these processes really require possibly unrealistic from a biological point of view, amounts of training. So the example of learning to grasp manipulate the object, the cube with the 36 GPUs, et cetera, or prior knowledge that is not clear how it's incorporated. In contrast, muscle synergies that we can define really as sort of grouping of degrees of freedom or muscle activation in a sort of coordinated way might simplify this mapping because they provide a low dimensional set of basis function, essentially to generate just the adequate necessary muscle control and muscle pattern. Then in a modular controller, then learning a new sensory motor policy essentially requires changing this mapping again in a very simplified schematic way. And this can require either changing the combination of existing synergies. This is likely what happens when you adapt a new task. And the new goal can be achieved by using the same muscle patterns, just remapping it differently, or by learning new synergies. And this likely occurs when we learn a new motor skill that requires actually new motor patterns, new strategies, potentially sequencing of muscle patterns, etc. Then really the key question, focusing on motor skill again, which is the focus today, we know that motor skills can be sort of described as an increase in speed and accuracy, as been mentioned, with practice. However, how this occurs, what is the learning process? Maybe there is a cost function that is optimized, but what is the cost function? What is the algorithm optimized? These are essentially still open questions. Now, however, one important observation when you look in a skill is that simple motor skills are often performed in a stereotype way. There is a unique solution. However, complex real-life motor skills involving many degrees of freedom very often have multiple solutions. Then the question is really how to deal with this. Often uniqueness, unique solution emerge the result both because data are actually average across participants. So often inter-individual differences are treated as noise, but this has the risk of hiding multiple individual solutions. As this is a very schematic representation shows, you can have a trend in average data or even no trend, but if you look at individual data, you can have actually an opposite trend in some subjects or even having different groups, different classes of subjects. Then really the key point I would like to make today is that rather than discarding inter-individual differences, for example, by averaging, they can provide useful information, additional information that is not just on the average for understanding and for unraveling the learning process. And in the context of modularity, one key question becomes when you learn a new skill, are different individuals learning individual different synergies as to solve the problem, to achieve that skill? Or maybe there is a single sort of cost function landscape, but different skills and different strategies are due to individual ability to learn. So maybe different levels of completeness of learning. Now, so briefly today, what I will present are two approaches to investigate individual differences. First, as a fundamental essential prerequisite to characterize complex skills is that having complex characterization on individual performance, individual strategies. And I'll start with that. But then I will present this approach that of virtual surgeries that provides a systematic way to for investigating learning of new muscle synergies. So let's start for the first. What we use essentially as a model skill is really a natural unconstrained overarm throwing. And these essentially shows very large inter-individual differences. The experimental setup here you see in the lab is simply having a motion capture of a subject, both of the subject whole body of a ball, throwing at targets at 6 meter distance. So we recruited non-expert right-handed participants. And we could essentially characterize whole body motion during throws to different targets. As you can see here, these in different colors are the trajectory of the different body targets of 12 or 20 participants. And you can see there is a large amount of variability of differences to achieve essentially the same task. Here, pay attention particularly to the feet, some subjects do not move the feet, other steps with the left or with the right, and then the arm motion are widely different. So I will present two methods to deal with this complexity. First, that of looking at low-dimensional representation of the whole body kinematics, and then looking at the relationship between the characteristic, the throwing, so the release parameter, the position and velocity of the release of the ball, and the performance, the different level of performance in a throwing task, using a new method, so we're proposing a Hessian-based decomposition. So if we think about multiple repetition, multiple trials of whole body kinematics, you can have a number of variables. Of course, they vary over time, and different trials have different components. If we simply take this kinematic data and we rearrange it as a large matrix with the, you know, each column is a trial, and so there are many rows, as many sort of body parts, joint angles, joint markers, for example, time samples, we can, with simple principal component analysis, decompose these time-varying data as a product, essentially, of some what we call spatiotemporal principal components, because each component has both space, body part, and time, and a very compact number of trial-dependent combination coefficients. Now, using this combination, this reconstruction, we can approximate the actual recorded trajectory. Here we see two participants with five principal components, already good reconstruction. With 10 is better, of course, and with 23, the error is very low, less than sort of 97% of variance accounted for. Even with 10 components, the major feature of these trajectories are captured. And this is a huge reduction in dimensionality because the whole data is really 18 markers times three coordinates and 100 time samples is like a very large, 5,400. Whereas with few coefficients, we can capture this. Now, in this low-dimensional representation, here you see the first three principal components on two different views, and the different colors are the distribution of individual sort of coefficient, individual subject coefficient. Each color is a different participant. You can clearly see there are differences, and also the different subjects, group of subjects appear to be clustered. Indeed, by running a simple k-mean clustering analysis, we can group with, completely without any ad hoc sort of picking up any features by hand, but data-driven, four different classes that correspond to reasonable sort of types, styles of throwing, without stepping, for example, with the left step, right step, and double step. So this is sort of a data-driven classification that allows to characterize different throwing styles with a whole body complex kinematics. Second methods I would like to briefly introduce today is that of relating now the parameters of the release, like Dagmar was showing her skittle task, essentially position and velocity, but here is unconstrained in 3D, so a six-dimensional sort of release parameter, to the error, that, for example, the distance from the center of the target that the subject is trying to achieve. And of course, if you have many repeated trials, what it matters to the subject is to minimize the mean error. So if you have a score, for example, a square distance, is the mean score that represents really the performance in the task. Now, we have essentially, you know, action space, high dimensional potential action space, some outcome space, for example, where it lands, and some scalar function, for example, the distance from the target. And it's this mapping between action space, high dimension, and score that characterizes the performance of the subject. Now, if you think about the performance, this performance function could be nonlinear, but if it's smooth, you can simply use a Taylor decomposition. And then if we take essentially the average, that is the integral, if you want, over the distribution of action, then the mean score, that is a performance, can be simply decomposed as a term that we call alpha, which is simply the score of the mean action, plus a term that contains the Hessian matrix, which is the second derivative of the, essentially, of the local geometry, of the mapping between action and sort of and score, and the covariance matrix of the throws. Essentially, if we can take, for example, the trace of the covariance, we see that these beta terms depends on the trace of the covariance, but depends on also on the alignment, if you want, the noise tolerance of these distribution. Essentially, it's geometry and variability interact.
And Andrea, now, 2 minutes left.
Yeah. Yes. 2 minutes left? Oh, it's 12 minutes to watch. Yeah, sorry. Okay.
Sorry. 2 minutes. Sorry about
it. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. My fault.
Yeah. It's
three. I have
a chronometer. My watch is 13 minutes now. Yeah. It's okay. I'll try to be in 70. Now, so these performance indicators essentially allow to characterize individual subject performance. Here you see the 20 subjects in this alpha beta plane. And because alpha plus beta is the performance, essentially these diagonal lines are isoperforming subjects. Subjects have the same performance, but have different distribution of, if you want, of bias and variability and tolerance. And if you look in this eta versus beta plane, essentially noise versus variability tolerance, again, we have a, you know, a different subject with different amount of noise that can compensate noise with different level of tolerance. Moreover, if we see across different targets, we see that these individual features, these individual indicators are consistent across targets. So it indicates that these are really, as Dagmar said, there is invariance in these strategies because for different targets, they use the same parameters. Finally, in the last 3 minutes I have, I want to discuss a different approach in a simplified, if you want, a more systematic way, but looking at learning of new synergies. The point is really, if you want to be systematic at the same time, learn something which is typically what happens in complex skills that require a long time. So what we devise is a way of altering the mapping between motor commands and the effect that they have. And if this altering is becomes sort of such that muscle synergies become ineffective, this will force, will induce subjects to learn new synergies. How to do so? With a sort of a tendon transfer, for that we call it virtual surgery. Takes this simple, again, toy example. You have four muscles that generate force at the hand. Let's say these two muscles, to flex or elbow shoulder, form a synergy. Sort of, that means that the force sum and this synergy, coordinated activation muscle generate a force in this direction. If I transfer this muscle, I cut the tendon and suture here, these two muscles become ineffective because the force that becomes agonist and antagonist pairs. So then the subject will have to learn a new synergy. We didn't do any actual surgery, but in a isometric sort of force production task in virtual reality, we map forces or EMGs directly in cursor movement. And then we could remap the effect that EMG or muscle activity has on the simulated force. For example, by looking at a simple linear model, we can map each muscle in a certain force direction in the plane, and then identify synergies with standard technique, non-negative matrix factorization, this corresponds to pattern of muscle co-activation, and associate force to each muscle. Then we can simulate a rearrangement of the tendons by moving the force pulling direction of each muscle, but in a complex way such that the synergy, the forces associated to the synergies are also altered. In this case, you see on top, we call this a compatible surgery simply because these forces still span the full force space. But we can do another sort of surgery that aligns the force associated with synergies, so subject will not be able to activate forces, generate force in the orthogonal direction. And indeed, what we showed a few years ago with Dennis Berger is that if you look at the trajectory during sort of learning of this task in the compatible case, subject learn, but not in the incompatible. In a single day, the percent of an unsuccessful trial remains very high for the incompatible in red, but whereas the learn, green the learn. Now, what we've been doing more recently with Daniele Borzelli is to see if longer time, longer practice, as in most motor skills, can lead to learning of new synergies. And indeed, a subject here is an example. The first day is unable to do, at the end of the first session, to reach all targets, but with more time, with the subject learns, and of course, in a compatible case. Overall, of the subjects, we can see that in the first, in a single day session, out of three consecutive days, there's no improvement, but at the third day, there's large improvement, almost similar to that of the compatible surgeries. However, and this comes really the key message I want to give today, if we look at this average behavior of the incompatible surgeries, you see this behavior. If you take a group of subjects, individual learning curves, you see indeed these they learn, but there are also another group, six subjects that learn quite well, but three other subjects, even in the third day, didn't achieve any significant improvement. This is suggesting that there is really large inter-individual variability. In conclusion, if you want to study learning of complex motor skill, we need really methods and techniques to compactly characterize the strategies and see how they relate to performance. Moreover, with the technique I propose, these virtual surgeries provide a tool to systematically investigate changes, difference, individual difference in learning of synergies. And we'll want to move from these, as Dagmar has done in the Skittle task, to see learning, but also altering the dynamics. For example, seeing how new dynamics in virtual reality can be learned. And for the virtual surgeries, what we are setting up to do now is actually to look at the neural correlates. So we can look at magnetic resonance, functional or structural, to see If there are specific changes in connectivity, in morphometry, when compatible and compatible synergies are learned. And with this, thank you. And thanks to many collaborators, and in particular, in this work, the first part, Antonella and Paolo, and Daniele and Mauro, and the second part. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Andrea. I did not want to cut you earlier. I guess we had different clock. Thanks a lot. There are a couple of questions that came. What?
18 minutes 44 on my watch. Sorry for being long.
Counting. There are a couple of questions that came up on Zoom. Please have a look at them, and we'll answer them during the 10 minutes discussion.